Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
You mentioned that what I'm going to talk about is essentially a framework to do Wyner-Ziv coding. I don't know. Are you guys familiar with Wyner-Ziv coding?
Well, some.
Okay, then might be easier. Essentially, I'll cover three aspects. The outline is like the following. I'll spend maybe in the first 5 minutes and then start with a network information theory perspective, because essentially that's what we're doing. Second bullet is pretty much what are we doing in the related areas. It turns out Wyner-Ziv is essentially just one of the small problems. So it's a dual problem that is about 30 papers, so we have been working on this last year. In order for me to cover this Slepian-Wolf coded quantization paradigm for Wyner-Ziv coding, I need to spend some time kind of explaining using the Slepian-Wolf coding, the practical design to the user. Then it will be easy to go from there to Wyner-Ziv coding. As I mentioned, I'll talk about the performance analysis, code design for ideal sources, and then we'll deal with the practical sort of scenario and application. I'll focus on the first two, distributed video coding. This is in terms of, I guess, you know, research potential or actual amount of research for my group and other groups. So there's a whole lot more right now done in the research community area, distributed video coding. This is the area that is really coming up. Of course, you have a covert network. Turns out you can use Wyner-Ziv coding to realize a lot of the performance gains. And it's a very, very exciting area that is really involved. This is another potential application area. You've seen a lot of papers, talking about sensor networks. In the sensor networks, obviously there's a good match between distributed coding and the sensor networks. But actually, so far I haven't seen any practical schemes. So a lot of potential. I think this is probably a tougher area to address. That's why I leave it to the end, and I will mention some ideas and come up with the new words that might be good. So we're talking about network information theory, but let me just briefly use just one slide to kind of review Shannon's classic information theory results. Because I taught information theory, so I think the main results in Shannon's work actually are the source and channel coding theorems and the dispersion theorem. And these are essentially what have been kind of driving, we call this the IP revolution. The next, in the previous 55 years, the source, first compress, of course. And then because the channel is noisy, we add error protection to basically protect these sources from channel errors. Then we have a channel decoder, to keep the source decoder. That's pretty much the paradigm in many the current video communication applications. Now we have essentially a network work, internet, wireless network. In terms of theory, we do not have a unified network information theory as we have in the point-to-point case. So the next slide, I'm going to show some sort of areas where we have nice results. I call them triumphs, And more importantly, I want to highlight the down notes. That's why we do not have a unified number theory. The first one is the simplest sort of three-note relay, you know, case. We have the source and we have the destination. We have an extra node that acts as relay or the helper to help, you know, transition from the source to the destination. But even for such a simplest, you know, case, the capacity of the relay channel is not known. So far, we only have some bounds. I'll come back and talk about this in the use of the appropriate method. So we use Wyner-Ziv to, you know, help close it down. The slightly more general case will be, again, this is very simple. Okay? The interference channel. So we have two transmitters and two receivers. Each receiver receives quite a good signal from the intended receiver, but also interference from another transmitter. Likewise, this receiver receives a good signal here and interference. Again, for such a simple interference channel, the capacity limit is not. So you have a general sort of network setup, the problem is wide open in terms of performance limits. So there's a lot of, you know, exciting new and open problems to work on. The good news is that for certain cases or several cases, we have, you know, the clean solution. Actually, for this broadcast case, where you have one transmitter and multiple users, receivers, the different cases. For the scalar broadcast channel in the Gaussian case, the result actually is well known. But we only found out the capacity region of the vector Gaussian broadcast case last year. So it wasn't easy. Eventually, the capacity region of this vector case depends on what is called dirty paper coding, which is the dual of Wyner-Ziv. And right now, we're working on code design. The simplest case will be what is called the MAC or maximum multiple access channel, where you have, you know, multiple users sharing this same channel while transmitting. This is the simplest case, and the problem is solved way back in 1972. And we have one MAC decoder design. Actually, let me just say a few things about this relay channel. You can think of the relay as a combination of this broadcast, one transmitter, two receivers, and a MAC channel. So when we do coding for this relay channel, later on we have a MAC decoder because it's easier to run. Then, of course, the highlight of networks in this theory will be Slepian-Wolf and Wyner-Ziv coding. That's what got everything started. Wyner-Ziv, Slepian-Wolf work really is a major success story. Let me put these things in sort of this table in terms of duality between source coding and channel coding. We know that, you know, the classic source coding, you know, is the dual of classic channel coding, Shannon theory. But then in the sort of the network information theory perspective, on the source coding side, you have Wyner-Ziv coding, which is lossy source coding with signed information. And you have a dual problem in channel coding that's called Gelfand-Pinsker. And then the special case of that is the Gaussian case, that's also called dirty paper coding. Then you can further generalize Wyner-Ziv coding to consider terminal source coding, where you have multiple lossy encoders with one joint decoder. And actually, we consider two types of model terminal source coding problems. Okay, one is actually the well-known CEO problem. For the Gaussian case, the theoretical limit is known. But for another case that we call a direct model terminal case, the theoretical sort of rate region is not really actually, we work a lot right now, still working on this problem. That's why I use the red color here. The dual of the model terminal source coding problem will be coding for the MIME broadcast channel. We just start working on this area. Multiple description coding was kind of still, I guess, an active research area, starting from, I guess, the mid-90s. Again, people, you know, took a practical approach to this problem. And we plan to probably, you know, later work on this multiple discrete encoding problem along the same lines of what we've been doing in terms of Wyner-Ziv model transformation. And finally, the dual of model discrete encoding in the channel coding perspective will be coding for math. And finally, as I mentioned, these areas are the ones that we have worked on. And if we start getting here and later on, we might do that. So let me quickly go over sort of related research in my group. We started working on Slepian-Wolf coding about 4 years ago. And then we migrated to Wyner-Ziv coding. And last year, we were working on auto-terminal coding. These essential problems, you know, consider as perfect channel. So the channel is noisy. And when the channel is noisy, in the Wyner-Ziv setup, or even in the Slepian-Wolf setup, we have what is called the distortion-rate of channel problems. And this is kind of the part that I'm going to talk about. We use Wyner-Ziv to help get the relay to in one mode to just enhance the transmission. We started this part of the last year. We have one piece of work that basically dealt with the combined Slepian-Wolf and network coding. So we treat Slepian-Wolf coding as one way of doing practical network coding. Later on, we'll mention that Slepian-Wolf essentially involves computing the syndromes, encoding. So it's the one way of doing linear combinations with the text without the nodes. Then last year, we focused on this problem of near capacity dirty paper coding, essentially a dual problem of finding this. And because of the time constraints, I will only cover pink colors. And right now we're working on applications of dirty paper coding. One major, I think, application areas of that would be image data hiding, in general data hiding. Also, we know that the capacity region of the minor broadcast channel essentially relies on dirty paper coding. So we could start doing coding. So let me now start with Slepian-Wolf coding, and then I'll talk about Slepian-Wolf coding. This is actually a special case of Slepian-Wolf coding. General Slepian-Wolf field deals with near lossless coding of correlated sources, multiple correlated. Here, I assume that the type information for Y is already perfectly available to decoder. Then, this special case of Slepian-Wolf coding or false coding design information deals with suppression X. To this low limit, that is the condition entropy of X given R. And then the decoder is jointly done. In other words, the decoder takes the transmitted version of X and the signed version to jointly reconstruct X hat. X hat asymptotically is the approach of X perfect to generate the top of the error. So the sort of Slepian-Wolf rate region for two sources essentially has basically three boundaries. These are the R1 will be so limited by this condition entropy, which I mentioned here. Likewise, R2 will be so limited by the condition entropy of H of Y given X. What is interesting is this diagonal line. Essentially, it's lower limited by the joint entropy. So essentially, what this says is that separate or distributed encoding of correlated sources will be as efficient as joint encoding. That's the surprising result. Now, any region outside these two lines will be distributed. So anything inside this triangle will be encoded. Particularly, any code design that approaches this diagonal line will be very, very desirable. So this problem of source coding with isolation essentially tries to approach this corner by assuming that you send HY to basically convey this source to the decoder. Then the goal is to approach this point horizontally to the left. That's the problem. And we have works that deal with general designs to approach any point along this diagonal line. But for this one of the problem, that's all we need frame that we're approaching this corner. So that will be our focus. The approach is actually to introduce a correlation channel. So we think of the side emission as the output of this hypothetical correlation channel with the source X in the input. With that, and then you know we have a good handle on this. So the setup is essentially like this. So the side information Y is perfectly available at the decoder. Then the goal is to compress X into this lower limit, which is the condition entity. And once we have the channel, okay, what do we do is to design a channel code for this correlation channel. By transmitting the syndromes of the channel code, essentially we can approach the Slepian-Wolf limit if the channel code is designed to approach the capacity of this correlation channel. So we have completely transformed this Slepian-Wolf problem into an equivalent channel code. And then, the problem becomes finding efficient codes like LDPC or triple codes for this problem. And let me sort of briefly explain the idea of the zone concept. Suppose we have a linear NK binary code. So we start with binary sources. We have two IID correlated binary sources. I'm going to do a length and block coding. So I take, say, a block of m bits, so there are 2 to the m possible inputs. I partition these 2 to the n possible inputs into 2 to the m minus k subsets or cosets. Then each coset will have 2 to the k code words. And then, essentially, when I partition the cosets, I'm going to use the syndromes to index them. This is what I'm doing. So I have 2 to the k length and binary code words in each coset, and I have 2 to the m minus k coset. The way I partition is that the coset with 0 syndromes will correspond to the 2 to the k valid code words of the nk code. And the rest are just basically shifted versions of the same code. In that way, I preserve the distance problem. And this is very important in terms of having the same power of error in decoding. Then because I'm inputting n bits and outputting n minus k bits, so the compression ratio is n over n minus k. Then we have a rate 1/2 code, then my compression ratio is 1. Now, there are, a few assumptions. First of all, we have this symmetric assumption. And also, here we're dealing with binary sources. For the memory sources, again, symmetry is always an important assumption. Because otherwise, you're dealing with non-conventional channels with non-symmetric correlation, or even channels with memory. And they don't actually, when we talk about Wyner-Ziv, most of the cases, the channel between the quantized source and the side emission is not symmetric. So we have some new work that deals with that. But for now, this is kind of the basic idea that really kind of explains the idea of compression.
In the memory case, do you assume symmetry even between the various other receivers, or is it just a rotational symmetry? That is, can I have, I'll have the same row vector, but I could have rotations of it, or do you assume that all the non-diagonal entries are the same?
I have examples. The key again is to come up with the correlation model. Right. So we have, two projects. One deal with the Slepian-Wolf coding of 3 sources. Then we have another one that deal with, generally, say, 4 sources or memory sources generally. But the actual design example that we gave all assumes symmetric correlation, where you can build a sort of the symmetric channel model. So the crossover probability is essentially awesome. But I won't have time to talk about that. So let me briefly extend this syndrome idea to the general case. And that idea works for all linear codes, okay, especially LDPC codes or large size block codes. It also works for convolutional turbo codes. So essentially right now I consider turbo and LDPC codes same thing. So I don't distinguish. As I mentioned, the key is to model the correlation. once you have the correlation, essentially you know the channel characteristics, then you know your goal is to design a channel for that channel. Now, there are researchers who basically use this parity-based approach, like conventional channel coding in a systematic setup. But instead of transmitting both the systematic bits and the n minus k parity bits, they just transmit the n minus k parity bits to achieve the same compression rate. But because here you cannot say that you know, the distance probably is preserved, as in the syndrome approach. So I want to say that syndrome-based approach is the optimal one. And you can, in practice, you can use this parity-based approach, but the performance will be worse than it. And this is especially true later on when we talk about distributed. So I tend to classify the syndrome-based approach as the optimal one for the Slepian-Wolf case. And later on, again, I don't have time to talk about the parity-based approach for the distributed system. Over there, actually, the parity-based approach is optimal when the channel is more. So let me just quickly review this background on binary LDPC code. So we have these source bits, and then output will be the syndrome bit. And we assume a binary symmetric channel with possible probability P. Okay, so the smaller the P, the higher the correlation. Typically, P is between 0 and 0.5. So above 0.5, just you flip everything. Encoding is very simple, just simple addition. Decoding, we initialize the sort of the left node with the side information. Okay, that's our file information, we start with. A decoding just has a slight change over the standard sum product of a belief propagation algorithm. So it actually is here. So the hyperbolic tangent rule is like that. The S is the syndromes. If the syndrome is zero, then it's just essentially the classical sum product algorithm. If the syndrome is negative, all we have is just a sign flip. And that's the only change in the standard sum product algorithm. And as I mentioned, because LDPC codes can be designed to approach the capacity of the BSC, and we can expect very good results in Slepian-Wolf code. So this is just one example that we did. The horizontal axis is the initial entropy, that is H of P. Again, as I mentioned, the smaller the P, the higher the correlation, the smaller of the Slepian-Wolf limit. So in this way, the source X will be easier and easier to compress. The vertical axis is the bit error rate. So we fix bit error that tend to negative 6 and compare different codes. And we have two sources. I have different codes. All the codes have rate 1/2. So I try to compress 2 to 1. And then this will be my Slepian-Wolf limit of 0.5. Actually, for these curve, we show the Wyner-Ziv limit for the binary case when we use this distortion, but again, I won't. So let's just focus on this point that is definitely important. We designed different codes. Let's see, these red curve is the best result we get with lengths 10 to the 5 irregular binary LDPC codes. The bound is at 0.5, and the best performance here will be 0.47. So we lose 0.03 bit for the binary source case. That'll be a rule of thumb later on what we're going to use in the LDPC code. And we use irregular, this is 10 to the 5, at length 10 to the 4, see, we have basically reduced performance. And then we also have regular LDPC codes. You see that irregular codes perform better than regular codes. And likewise, we have triple codes, parallel concatenation, 10 to the 5, and these two are triple codes designed with serial concatenation, 10 to the 4 and 10 to the 5. So parallel concatenation does better than serial. So you see the gap between essentially turbo and LDPC is about 0.02. Finally, this is the result that been reported from a group at Stanford that uses the parity-based approach, which is n minus k parity-based, which is matter program. You see, obviously, there's quite a large gap in LDPC, even the turbo, 10 to 5, 30, which is 1 minute program.
parameters, more detail in this communication analysis. Okay, so now we can sort of, you know, generalize the binary case.
Can you comment on how this performance of different code changes when the code rate is different? I mean, currently you are operating on a code rate of 1/2. How about, let's say, I operate on code rate of 1/4 or 1/8?
Okay, I believe the sort of the gap should stay constant if the design is well done. But again, I think, okay, it's harder to design higher rate codes to achieve higher compression. You see, the higher the rate the code, you know, the more compression you're trying to do. In general, it's easier to design lower rate code.
Basically, what's happening is that as the rate is going higher, the performance of hard code basically will shift.
In practice, yeah, it's harder to design good performance high rate codes. But once you have it, you know, the code design, I think we have different rates. As I recall, the gap will be pretty much.
I ask this because you know, in Wyner-Ziv coding, I mean, we are dealing with bit pairs.
Yeah.
I think a lot of bit pairs you're operating at code rate, which is pretty low.
Yeah. Then, you know, basically you're not really compressing that much. Then your code design is a bit easier.
Compress a lot. If the code rate is low.
So the code rate is high, then you can, because the code rate is n, compression ratio is n over n minus k.
In that case, what I'm asking is, if the code rate is high,
for
compression,
for example, if your condition entropy is like 0.9, I don't think your compression is basically sensitive.
Okay,
thank you.
Okay, thank you. Can you see it again?
I'm sorry. If the compression rate, you know, you have to go to like
Okay.
Then you're designing a rate 9/10 code.
Yeah.
And overall, it's, as I mentioned, it's 0.03 bit per bit point.
0.03.
On average, yeah. I think that that rule of thumb works out pretty well.
In that case, basically the gap between the practical code versus the ideal code becomes larger, right?
No, I believe it's about the same.
Okay,
as
right.
long as you have a long enough code.
Okay.
I think the largest length is 10 to 6. Typically, in this case, it's 10 to 5. The gap again is 10 to 3. So in general, as I mentioned, as long as you can manage to design the code, the gap should be roughly the same. Although it's harder to design high rate codes. So the generalization to the error rate source will be interesting because in practice, you will most likely deal with error rate sources. So there are works in the channel coding literature that deal with multi-level LDPC codes now. The idea is essentially just you do sort of multi-stage decoding, okay, and do sort of designing, you know, multi-level binary LDPC codes. It's all in the decoding part. And this is itself is sort of, you know, interesting successful coding problem. So in one project, we had a paper to deal with in general multiple memory in the Slepian-Wolf setup. Again, the idea is just to follow this multi-stage of multi-level LDPC codes. And as you mentioned, this is basically an integral part of our quantitative code design. After quantization, essentially, we're dealing with Slepian-Wolf coding at the quantized source to design the decoder. So essentially, we're using Slepian-Wolf coding as a condition entry code to compress to the condition entry code to the quantized source given the time. So let me kind of, you know, summarize, you know, our work on Slepian-Wolf coding. So far, essentially, we have been treating Slepian-Wolf coding problem as one of channel coding. So we have tried to use all the progresses made in the channel coding literature, so whatever they have done, and just kind of apply the tools and algorithms in the Slepian-Wolf coding problem. And there are, I think, at least three open problems in terms of Slepian-Wolf coding. As I mentioned so far, we typically assume it's symmetric for the tools to deal with. For non-conventional channels such as, you know, the correlation, channels are non-symmetric or channels with memory, and these all kind of, you know, tougher problems. And in the Wyner-Ziv setting, later we're going to talk about, mostly, very likely, the channel between each bit of the quantized source and the cycle is not symmetric. So we kind of generalize the concept of symmetry to what we call pure symmetry. And it turned out, you know, this is another special case we can work out the design.
So what do you mean by
this? Yeah, well, there's a sort of a technical definition. You have, well, there's a, okay. If you plot out the correlation, is essentially it's like that.
Okay.
Mathematically, yeah, we have it there. Actually, the paper just came out
last week.
Another open issue is, I call it the scalable Slepian-Wolf coding, in the sense of arithmetic coding, which is string coding. This will be very desirable for scalable multimedia compression type applications, for example, streaming. But I think it's extremely difficult to have a scalable Slepian-Wolf. The tougher problem, I think, is what is so-called universal Slepian-Wolf coding. So far, we assume we know the correlation. What you do not know, you have to learn. That's what we mean by universal. Optical correlation. Cesar, in a paper that in the 1980s, actually showed the existence of such a universal correlation. But we took a look at it, and we found there's little progress in this area. Mostly it's because the code design is difficult. Actually, mostly in the joint decoder. The complexity is too high. We submitted papers to IT with partial results.
Once the paper's out, our appreciation.
Oh, sure. So now let me quickly move on to Wyner-Ziv coding. With the background we built up on Slepian-Wolf coding, it's pretty easy. This is the one slide that kind of basically gives the definition. So the only difference between Slepian-Wolf or source coding with perfect self-definition and the Wyner-Ziv coding is that this encoder is lossy. So we're talking about rate distortion problems with signed information as a decoder. In the classical case, without signed information, the rate distortion function of coding X will be defined as basically the increment of this rate information under the distortion. Here, in the Wyner-Ziv setup, this is the Wyner-Ziv rate distortion function. It's defined as, again, the increment of this mission information. Here, you have the side information. Z will be, you can consider as the coded version. Under, actually now we have two constraints. One is this Markov condition, the Y, X, and Z, and of course you have this. In general, because of the lack of side information at the encoder, you suffer in terms of rate at the fixed function compared to this condition rate version, where the side information is available both at the encoder. So what does this mean that in general, one of the coding suffers with one? And Zamir actually characterized these loss asymptotically. For both cases, one is the binary sources with ham distance, another case is the computer sources with mean square errors. Here we're interested in this special case of what we call the quadratic Gaussian case. Quadratic means mean square error distortion. So I have two jointly Gaussian sources. This will be the correlation matrix. In this case, turns out the one of the rate distortion function is exactly the same as the classic definition of rate distortion, which is basically 1.5 log. This is actually the variance of the innovation system, as well as the correlation system. And this special case is very interesting because in practice you can model a lot of these image and video sources as jointly Gaussian sources after the subject domain. So let me sort of, well, I guess because of the time constraint, I list a few sort of, you know, previous works on Wyner-Ziv code design. I won't go through the details. And the approach I'm going to propose is the following. I'm going to start with the classical sort of transform quantization and entropy coding paradigm without signing condition. Then, you know, as I mentioned, we can use or replace entropy coder with a syndrome-based entropy coder. So instead of using, say, Hoffman arithmetic coding, I'm going to use syndrome-based entropy. Then, okay, when the decoder has signed inversion, essentially I'm going to kind of, you know, do different things in each of these forms. For the transform block, okay, we should use what is called the conditional theorem. It's work done by Mike Gossbach. I'm going to assume that. So in this case, I'm going to assume that my source is already ID correlation. And then in the quantizer part, okay, we should use what is so-called a nested. Essentially, in the quantizer, you can take the decoder side inversion into account. And then apply what is called a nested quantizer. And then this is the basically the block, okay, that corresponds to the entropy coding block. Now, with the side inverted decoder, what you have to use is the Slepian-Wolf, the syndrome data. But this one, okay, essentially, we already take the time to sign the joint decoder. Okay, because the classical entropy coding approach won't be there to apply to decoder time. And then with this, assume ID sources, you really do have this left hand code.
You said in the nested quantization, you use the decoder side information. What is there a feedback?
No, it's a way of taking modeling. You said.
What is the nested quantization different from the normal quantization?
Okay, I think I have some slides, and then let me try to follow on, and then later I'll come back to your question. But the basic idea is following. You know that the decoder has some information, okay? How, you know, do you do differently, you know, in the classical quantization, you know, sort of approaches to reflect the fact? And one way of doing that is to just measure. Okay, so this is a general block diagram of Wyner-Ziv coding. So you have a source X. So first you basically apply the source coding or quantization here. Okay, you have the quantization indices. Then you apply the Slepian-Wolf encoder to compress to essentially the condition entropy if I output in this zone. So the encoder is quite simple. Just, you know, follow the quantization with the Slepian-Wolf encoder. Then the decoder, you need to do more work. First, it takes the syndrome and it combines with the side inversion to do joint source decoding and comes up with a basically approximation of the source. But then, depending on the rate, a lower rate estimation plays a big role. Okay, the idea is that at lower rate, you're not giving much, you know, new information, so I have to really rely more on the side. But at a high rate, you know, you can afford to transmit, you know, all the needed information. So the role of the side really becomes less. So the whole thing, it evolved both source and channel coding problems. That's why I call basically one of the source coding problems. There are two types of losses. One is the quantization loss, which is, you know, source coding. Another one is what we call the binning loss. And what we learned is that we can essentially just do separate source of channel coding. Quantize, actually, you can even use a classic quantize. And then your job of selecting wolf coding will be a problem. So I'm going to start with, you know, a nested quantizer, and then worry about, you know, selecting wolf coding to compress to the condition. So right now, I think the approach is very clear. As I mentioned, estimation only basically zero at the lower rate. High rate really ignore SP. Here's something I think is very fundamental. Okay. What I mean is here, okay, the horizontal axis will be the dimensionality, okay, of the lattice code. As we know that we can use lattices for both source code and channel. And then the top row will be, okay, the rate distortion limits or the channel capacity for the Gaussian channel or sources. The horizontal axis will be the gap. So as we know that if I use a 1D uniform scalar quantizer for Gaussian source, I lose 1.5 dB. This is in terms of granular gain. Okay, assuming perfect against entropy. As I increase the dimensionality of my lattice code, and you can compute the bound in terms of the gap of the k-dimensional lattice code to the rate distortion limit. Turns out, for codes like, you know, quantizers like TCQ, trellis coded quantization, the equivalent dimensionality, it will be about 70, which is 0.2 dB away from the rate distortion limit.
Okay. On the other hand, if you use lattice codes to do channel coding, that depends on the power of error. So typically, we say the 10 to negative 6 will be the green line. As I increase the dimensionality, again, you know, my performance is going to improve. Right? But you see, the key is that, okay, even at, say, 250 dimensions, you still have more than 1 dB gap to the capacity of this network. So the point is that, okay, you really need very, very high dimensional equivalent lattice codes to approach the capacity of data. So obviously, of course, asymptotically, okay, if I let both the, you know, dimensionality of this source lattice code and the channel lattice code go to infinity, then I'm fine. So actually, that's the approach of Zamir. He proposes what is called a nested lattice code. Okay. But in practice, what we ought to do is to have this horizontal way. In other words, I prefer the same loss from both source code, the same loss from channel code, which means that we should use the source codes and channel codes of very, very different dimensionality. And that's the point. So instead of, you know, approaching the limit with the nested lattice code of the same dimension, same dimensional source code and same dimensional channel code, and let the dimensionality go to infinity, obviously you can approach the limit. But in practice, we should take this approach with different dimensional source and channel code, with roughly the same gap to the rate distortion function or the channel code. So this is sort of the main results of our Slepian-Wolf coded quantization framework. Okay. So if you assume ideal source channel code in terms of, you know, approaching the definition entropy, then Slepian-Wolf coded quantization essentially has the same gap as the classic entropy coded quantization with the respective rate distortion function. So here we know that entropy coded scalar quantization, as I mentioned, loses 1.53 dB. In respect to the distortion rate function. And Slepian-Wolf coded scalar quantization, this is the same amount of 1.5 dB. If you use 2D entropy coded lattice quantization, it will do a little bit better, it will lose 1.3 dB. And if we use lattice quantization, okay, coupled with Slepian-Wolf coding, if one is coding, you lose something. And these two could be, you know, it's rigorously true. For this case, even in the classical scenario, okay, you can only do simulation. So entropy code TCQ loses 0.2 dB. This is assuming a 256 state TCQ. Likewise, with the same state TCQ, okay, same performance gap. In terms of practical design, we'll start with the 1D case. Very similar in the 2D. So essentially here, we have a Cossack code. So you can first view this as a uniform scalar quantizer with step size Q. And then, okay, here's the idea of nesting. So I'm going to essentially do binning. Okay, later on, I can explain to you. Okay, you have X and Y. Okay, the way to do nest the quantizers is basically assume that the top bits of X and Y are essentially the same. Then you only basically translate the intermediate bit plane. And the bottom bit plane is obviously your quantizer. And that's the reflected here, okay, because I have four cosets, 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 2, 3. Because I'm only translating basically. So there's an underlying coset channel code indexed by these, you know, 0, 1, and 2 cosets. So the minimal distance between the cosets will be 4 cubes. In general, it depends on the number of cosets. So the n cosets, then your minimal distance will be n. So here you have a one source code covered, okay, with the channel code. Actually, the source code is the fine lattice, and the channel code is the fourth lattice. So you have the source coding loss at high rate will be Q squared over 12. But the bottom line is proportional to Q. And then the loss due to channel coding is inversely proportional to the minimum distance. The larger the minimum distance, the smaller the in this case, because it's Gaussian, you can guide it by the Q power. So the bottom line is that, okay, I want to minimize the total distortion due to both source code and channel. But this term is proportional to the quantization step size. This is pretty much inversely proportional. So I can basically find the best trade-off or the optimal key to minimize the total distortion. So this is what do we have in terms of the performance. The horizontal axis is the rate. The vertical axis is the administrative error log scale. So we have this 6 dB in the performance. The model is the following. X is my source. Y is the signed information. So X is Y plus. Okay, both X and Y are Gaussian. So essentially, the variance of Z characterizes the correlation. Smaller the variance of Z, Z essentially is the innovation. So the smaller the variance of Z, the higher the correlation. Okay, now let me explain. This curve is essentially the distortion rate function of independent coding of X. Just like the upper. And this is the Wyner-Ziv limit. And then I have this curve. This pink curve is the performance by doing just that 1D nested quantization. So actually, you can see here, this is where the performance we get was 2 bits, 4%, minimizing the total distortion, finding the optimal speed. And that's what we get. 2 bits, we get this. 3 bits, 4 bits, 5 bits. And we see an increasing gap from the limit as we increase the rate. And this is without Slepian-Wolf coding. If we add Slepian-Wolf coding here, we're getting rate savings. Huh? This is the self-entropy, the rate, this is the condition. And likewise, we go from here to here, here to here, here to here. So at high rate, indeed, we observe 1.53 dB gap. And then we have these points are the actual simulation. At a high rate, it's pretty much very close to the rest. But 2D case is very similar. Here, we used the optimal hexagonal lattice. So it's not easy thing. It took us a while to find the scaling. Every time you have to scale the, your nested lattice, find the best trade-off. Okay. Similar setup. This is the rate distortion function for the next along. This is the Wyner-Ziv limit. This is nested 2D nested lattice along. Again, you know, the increasing depth from the Wyner-Ziv limit. At a high rate with Slepian-Wolf coding, ideal Slepian-Wolf coding, we lose 1.26 dB. These light bluish points correspond to simulation. At low rates, in practice, we lose more because of the estimation is not up. At a high rate, we have, okay, from here to here, this is essentially a source coding loss. This vector would be the loss due to Slepian-Wolf coding mechanism. For TCQ coupled with Slepian-Wolf coding, this is the block diagram. Okay. So the encoder again is very simple. Actually, TCQ you can think of as already, you know, kind of the channel coded version because it uses the same. So what it would do is just, you know, use this Slepian-Wolf coder that outputs this endurance to achieve some error and assume an ideal error. So the decoder actually is more complicated. So I have a side information. Now, by the way, the syndromes includes, okay, the coded bits. This is will be the trellis bits. Okay. And then the rest will be the coded bits. So I have R bit TCQ. So first we could decode the TCQ bit. And what we do is start with the side information. We statistically reproduce X. We know the statistics of basically the channel. So we have the signed information. That way we generate, we produce the local likelihood ratio of the trellis bit given the signed information and use that to combine with the transmitted syndrome bit to estimate the trellis bit.
Just a comment. Yeah. First thing you are trying to statistically recreate.
Yeah.
That means you basically need to do several trials and get a statistics instead of just running one, basically. Would it's not like you basically just run through the Y through a TCQ encoder and get a single.
No, no. You see, that's what I meant. We start on Y. We know the statistics of the noise.
Yeah.
So we create just right, right. Regenerate a noisy sequence. Add to Y.
Okay.
And that will be my basically estimated X.
Okay.
And then you actually quantize X.
Okay.
This is all side information.
Yeah.
and combine with the transmitter trellis bit to decode the trellis bit. And then, okay, for each of these code word bits, then we just follow this multi-level LDPC code framework. We decode one bit at a time. Okay, so here will be the local active ratio given the size information, okay, and all the previous bits, okay, to estimate the next bit. So we do decoding. And finally here, this part, we did a lot of work to come up with a mounting estimate. And the details in the phenomenal paper published in 2003 Library. So this is the results by using just TCQ and Slepian-Wolf coding. Again, rate and distortion. I didn't put the plot the distortion of X and Y for bounds. Here again, at high rate, okay, we lose 0.2. But in practical coding, we lose more. With TCQ at about 3.5 bit, actually 3.8 per bit, we lose about 0.8 dB. At lower rate, 1.1 bits, we lose about 1.46. So what we did was to use 2D TCQ coupled with Slepian-Wolf coding. And then at a higher rate, we lose 0.47 dB. At about 1 bit per sample, we lose 0.6. So actually, at low rate, it's harder. So let me summarize and compare with the best results before our DC. That is the discus approach from Sandeep Pradhan and Cannon Rampendon. They had an earlier paper. Essentially, this uses trelloscopes, nested trelloscopes, TCQ and TCM. They lose 2 to 5 dB depending on the rate. High rate is 2 dB, low rate is 5 dB. So later on, they improved their design with Chow. The best result they got at the 1 bit per sample is 1.3 dB. Our result, as I mentioned, at the 1 bit per sample, we lose 0.6 dB. The high rate, we lose 0.4. Much better, order of magnitude better than the system. So our conclusion is that, you know, for ideal sources, with Slepian-Wolf coding on TCQ, we're approaching the theoretical limit. So now, before I get into the application, let me quickly, you know, mention successive Wyner-Ziv coding. This is very much like the classic, you know, successive coding problem, except that we have signing information. So you have encoder one generating one scheme to decode into a coarse approximation. Then you have a second encoder that generates a second layer base stream where you can combine with the first layer to decode a better quality. In general, when you have decoder signing information, they have different decoders, they could be different. But then the problem is very, very different. So we only constrain ourselves to the case where, you know, the signing information are the same. Then we can talk about, you know, successful refinement in the Wyner-Ziv. Obviously, this is a generalization of classical work of decoders and encoders. So there's the definition of successive refundability in the Wyner-Ziv case. Essentially, okay, it says, okay, if at different rates, you can basically achieve the same rate of performance without loss, then you call, you know, the sources successively refundable in the Wyner-Ziv case. So examples are the following. Okay. It turns out the joint Gaussian case, okay, with mean square distortion, they are successively refinable. That's very good. Okay. In addition, okay, even for the symmetric binary sources, okay, in practice, we know that there's rate loss with Wyner-Ziv coding. But then, you know, these type of sources are successively refinable. So you have two different concepts, rate loss versus successive refinability. Now, what's the intuition is because of the following. Because of the site information, you can come up with site information to help, okay, to make the source successfully refinable. So my student and I did some extensions on this successive refinement Wyner-Ziv coding, firstly done by Mehoff and
could you go back?
Yeah.
Is there some duality between successive refinability and physical degradability in broadcast channel?
We haven't, you know, looked into that, but on top of my head, I would say no.
I haven't really thought about the
channel. In general, I mean, non-degraded channel is very hard to handle. Yeah. But I do not see a connection between degraded channel and
successive channel.
Yeah, right now I don't see that.
Yeah.
We haven't looked. Our extension is the following. Sandeep and Pradhan showed that, okay, Wyner-Ziv has no rate loss as long as this channel Z is Gaussian. The side dimension does not have to be Gaussian. But we show that this class of sources is also successfully defined. In addition, we address the issue of layered Wyner-Ziv co-design by using nested scalar quantization, as I showed in that example. Because we use nested scalar quantization to facilitate successive defining. And then we, again, you know, apply Slepian-Wolf code to do successive or entropy coding. Then we apply to video, and that will be my next slide. So what do we do for layered Wyner-Ziv coding is to basically run a standard coder, could be MPEG-4, H.264, H.264. So you have a side information here, the base layer. Instead of, you know, MPEG-FTS, where it encodes the quantization error by, you know, fine PC and different coding. In the Wyner-Ziv setup, we encode the original by applying, in this case, the TCP as approximation, the original guarantee, and followed by nested scalar quantization and the decoder takes the side dimension combined with the sensitive frequency. In terms of the performance, this is rate and average TKSNR for fifth Foreman and modern daughter. This green curve will be the performance optimized at each point through the statistic cell. These points are the starting points of Wyner-Ziv code. And the uptick rate for the base layer and end versus here, the blue curve will be H.264 FTS. And the red curve will be the result generated by layered windings. And these points correspond to the layered boundaries. So you see, with layered Wyner-Ziv, the performance between FTS and Wyner-Ziv is very good. So we achieve pretty much the same thing. But then, you know, you wonder what's the, you know, advantage of doing Wyner-Ziv. So here's the point. The base layer is inherently more error robust to errors. Because in FTS, we always assume the base layer is perfectly received for the detail. Otherwise, you have error propagation and drifting. Here, okay, let me look at this, you know, 1D again, next to the quantize. I have original X here, and quantize to this X head. Then what I transmitted was just the green index. The decoder says that could be here, 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 and here. And then because the side information, essentially each side information, it gives you this region with minimal speed. So any Y side information within this, we call the vulnerable region of the coarse lattice channel code, will give you the same decoded X. So that's the fundamental reason why the Wyner-Ziv code has this error adjustment in terms of error happened to the base layer or the side information. Because in FGS, you know, you have to have, you have to decode the exact Y here to basically add to the conversion error. So any side information in this, you know, range of domain will guarantee the same decoded error. So we did some experiments. What we did was the following. We compare 26L, this is 26L, and Wyner-Ziv, by introducing the same, you know, percentage of lost macro block in the base layer. Okay, obviously now you see, this is, I think, assume the GOP size of 16. Within one GOP, as you know, progress, it says I, all the rest all P. Because of the error drifting, 26L FTS was basically lose a lot. Here, okay, we cannot guarantee that the, you know, the side dimension is always within that dimming limit. Right? But along with the init, well, okay, with the outside, you still have to drop. That's why, you know, the performance also is kind of degraded. to the field, but the drop is much less. Same is happening with the football field. That basically highlights the advantage of analysis. Here I show sort of just two frames. The left hand is the FPS coding, again 5% of the loss, the base rate. Yeah, with one of the qualities. Then let me just quickly go through sort of the project we did. When consider the case the channel is noisy, then we have what is also a distributed joint source channel. Again, we apply to video. Now the key idea is the following. Obviously, when the channel is noisy, you need to add error protection to the, you know, Wyner-Ziv coded distortion, all the syndromes. But we know that the syndromes are generated by channel code. So the idea is to combine, you know, Slepian-Wolf coding and the four error correction, you know, in one channel code. And then we use different codes. Typically, you can use the fountain codes, okay, for the streaming type of application. Another one is to basically use what is so called the raptor code that has a LDPC pre-code. In this case, we use RRA, the special class of LDPC, as the pre-code for Slepian-Wolf coding, plus essentially the fountain code. So again, you know, due to time constraint, I won't go through the details. Let me spend maybe, you know, a couple minutes on this new area of user cooperated networks in terms of, you know, code design. The idea is the following, okay? Because you have a network scenario, obviously this is, you know, again, I thought just, you know, showcase a relay scenario, okay? And these, in general, we have two users, right? They can help with that. That's the idea. To achieve better communication in terms of power, you know, throughput, and power. This is a hot area right now in network. And specifically, we consider this relay case. So we have a transmitter, a receiver, and a relay. The relay acts as a host. As I mentioned at the beginning, it's such a simple case, the capacity limit, you know, all we have is the bound. There are two modes for the relay channel to operate. We consider what is so-called the half duplex, which is simpler. So for each time slot, we partition into two. Alpha is the parameter you can see. Typically just at 50. So for the first half of the time slot, you essentially have a broadcast channel, as I mentioned. Right? One transmitter, two receivers, relay, and a session. Then for the second half of the time slot, then both, here in this case, the relay in the first time slot receives, second half of the time slot transmits. So it's just basically, that's why it has to, does not do the receiving and transmission simultaneously. That will be the full duplex. So in the second half of the time slot, essentially have the MAC channel, multiple access channel. So you can also talk about time division or frequency division, but essentially it's the same. So we're only focused on the time division. Now, here, okay, when the relay is close to the destination, then there will be a lot of correlation between, okay, what the relay has and what the destination is. So at the relay, what you can use is to take advantage of the sign information at the destination and use one of them. That's the whole idea. So the practical setup is the following. For this result project, we assume the Gaussian channel. Right now, we're working on the rotating channel. It's a little bit more complex because we're talking about outage capacity. But in this case, with the Gaussian case, it's simple. So we fix the channel coefficients. And then here's the source and destination. We assume the relay is moving along the distance between the source. As I mentioned, depending on where the relay is, if the relay is close to the source, actually there's a different mode that's called decoding force. If the relay really help, you know, close to me, then Jin, then, you know, Yong can clearly hear me, and then, you know, Yong can forward my message. So I'm looking at, you know, different distance. For example, here I constrain the distance will be 10, and then D will be 10. And we change the setup. Okay, we try to minimize the transmitter power, okay, to hit the capacity bound. So we are essentially minimizing the power. So here will be the distance between 0 and 10. So my relay is moving along, depending on different positions. here will be the minimum transmitter power. And this will be the lower bound of, in terms of the power to hit the capacity bound. This is the theoretical limit. You see, there are two practical bounds. One is from decoding forward, as I mentioned. The relay just decodes the message in forward. When the relay is close to the destination, obviously, you see, it actually operates pretty close to the bound. But then when D increases, the relay is close to the destination, which is a large gap, which means a compression forward, that's the basically the name where we use Wyner. It's still much better than decoding forward when the relay is close to the These are the theoretical bounds, okay. Assuming ideal Wyner-Ziv coding. Well, you might have a question why there's still a gap is because of the synchronization. I want to solve into that. So in terms of code design, here's the following. We have the source. Okay. For the first half of the time slot, we have a broadcast channel. Okay. Essentially, just we have a channel code, okay, from the source to the destination, and then another channel from the source to the relay. For the second half of the time slots, okay, it's more complicated. We're using first, okay, the relay is using Wyner-Ziv encoding, okay, transmits to the destination. Okay, then it does Wyner-Ziv decoding. There are two things. One is the MAC decoder, and another one is the MAC ratio combining for two different time slots. But the decoder, again, because this is the source code, it's more involved. Okay. So there are two main components. One is Wyner-Ziv, another is this MAC ratio combining.
Oh, yeah, that is the.
So let me just present this last slide with the results. These three curves are the original bound. This is the theoretical bound. This is the mode, when you do well, when the relay is close to the transmitter. And this curve is the practical performance, the practical decoding forward. We use turbo curve. And then this will be the bound with theoretical Wyner-Ziv or compression forward. In practice, this is what we get. The total loss from here to here will be due to source coding. From here to here will be due to channel coding. So you see, theoretically, the cross point is right here. In other words, after this distance, you use compression forward. But in practice, because both practical schemes were loose, essentially, even though theoretically it says in this regime here, between here, these two crosses, I think, we should use actually decoding forward, but in practice, it's better to use compression. Actually, this is the first practical design with the compression forward. Due to time constraint, I'll just quickly go through sort of the third application of Wyner-Ziv coding, okay, which is for distributed sensor network. This is ongoing work, and frankly, I think this is a very tough problem. So you have essentially this sort of video sensor network setup, different video sensors with this base station. They try to basically catch this thing. There are two approaches we've been thinking of. Imagine these are just, stereo video. Okay, you have two cameras capturing the stereo video of this moving train. One approach is just essentially do Wyner-Ziv. So you have a very low complexity video coder. Okay? It could be a streamlined version of H.264 with very, very low complexity. Because the power is really an issue in this setup. Okay. So then you have some side information, one channel of the video. Then the decoder needs to do a lot, and I call it, I guess two separate things. One is, has to do with correspondence analysis, like stereo matching. It has to do with your camera setup, the calibration, the focal point, and all that. Okay. So essentially, what you want to do is to start with one view and do some type of correspondence analysis to generate another view. Stereo image pair. Then after that, after the correspondent analysis, what is the correlation? And here I think it's easier. You can model as Laplacian what the system. Then you can do one of this. Then you will construct the second. So that's one approach. The second approach is actually use what I call model terminal source code. I think you get time to test that. So essentially, just run two separate quantizers for both channels. and then do what we call symmetric stuff in this case. We're not talking about the corner points now. So we have an approach to do this. But I think the hard part is actually the question and the correlation model.
I think most of the cases, you should be able to use time sharing to basically still rely on approach one to achieve about the point.
Yeah, in this case, you see, I have two separate, you know, quantized versions. Okay. I want to basically compress them to explore the correlation. As I mentioned, I could just, you know, design one channel code and do the channel code partition. But the key, again, is I need to know the correlation. The quantized source.
Yeah. Okay.
So we have some preliminary results for the first approach because you're right, it's easier to do one. Here, again, you know, we do not have the actual setup. We tried actually for a while to do this for a common analysis. Actually, this figure is generated by doing forward motion estimation. But how do you generate this type of information with decoder?
But the correspondent analysis, I mean, especially in the approach one, did you basically try to basically attempt decoding something like that?
Right now, okay, the decoder has one view, right? One channel. What you can do is do some type of optical flow. There are standard approaches in serial image or video coding. But again, you know, you have additional issues because you do not have all the time information. But I think some of the approaches you can borrow from.
Maybe you can
because you know your camera setup, right? The distance between the camera, the focal length, so you can do something. Eventually, when you set up the camera, you can calibrate all these parameters. So the key trick is, again, you have one channel. How do you estimate, you know, the second channel? You come up with the correlated version. So the better corresponding analysis, then I think the better modeling. So this is, we spent some time, we're still working. So we don't have to go. So that will be my last slide. Let me skip this. We have some examples when we, you know, compress just two correlated images. No video, just two correlated images. We use turbo code. I'll skip that. It's a home letter paper published. These are the students and all the young students. Most of the papers are on the web. Thanks.
Well, thanks for the excellent talk. Very appreciated.
Any questions?
Yes, we can talk offline. 15 minutes.